Keisha and Muttia both felt that the addition of Heidi gave them greater vocal options, but it still left them in the position of getting to know each other as they attempted to write a make or break album.
We didn't have a direction for the album at all. Like, we spent 7 months just writing every day. Like, we wrote 40 tracks and all, and just was just messing around with different sounds. And then we sat down with the record company at the end of it, and it was sort of obvious which tracks should go on the album because there was the better ones, the worst ones. And
we also worked with like a lot of different producers. With the last album, it was basically two or three main producers. With this one, we worked with about, like, let's say, eight producers who had their own individual sound. One would be like more of a rocky type, one would be more hip-hop, and one would be like more R&B. So I guess that influenced a lot on how the album sounded as well.
I mean, it's a good thing there's three of us, because there's always two verses and like a middle eight. So one will take whatever and we'll go off in separate corners, write about whatever, you know, we've chosen that we're going to write about, and then come back and
see
who's, sing it to each other. And whoever's part fits best for the first or second verse and the middle eight.
Most of the time we always have like if you remember, even back in the day, we always had like every verse sounded a tiny bit different. Yeah. I was run for cover and her verse was a dun dun. Mine was da 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 da. Every single time we do it, just to suit our own vocals and
it's
stuff.
It's good because it shows your fans like where you're coming from on that subject, because like we'll write our own verse on how we can relate to that subject and to suit our own voices. You know, it's better because you write it to suit your own voice and
the fans can see.
Yeah.
And that is like a... And it's only now, actually, we're listening to the album, we're just like, yeah, it's really nice because then the fans can see, like, because even though, like, sometimes we may even contradict each other in verses and stuff, and that's the reason why, because we all have our own opinions, we don't always agree on the same thing. Mm.
The difference...
It's a lot more up-tempo. Yeah. Angels with Dirty Faces, a lot more up-tempo, a lot more personality as well.
One Touch was more quite dark, indie, R&B.
And every track was like a demo as well. We just did basically most of the last album on a live mic. And when we came out of the studio, it definitely felt, especially listening back to the album, that we are now a vocal group, a lot tighter vocally than we've ever been before. And
much stronger.
Everything's going really well. So this album, definitely, and it's a lot more diverse as well.
Yeah.
And covers a lot more subjects since we've been going through such an emotional year. So
I think we'll have a lot more to write about on the next one now as well.
The success of Sugar Babes Mark II was heralded by the release of one of the best pop singles of the year, Freak Like Me, a mix of songs by Adina Howard and Gary Newman.
Basically, it was on White Label last year, and we were doing the recording the album, and our A&R came up to us and said, you know, we'll listen to it, see what you think of it, and, you know, try it out. And I think we all knew the original anyway, Adina Howard's version of Freak Like Me. So it was quite easy. It took us like a couple of hours just to go down there, lay in the vocals. And
We didn't even know it was going to be a single, but it was just funny.
It was most probably supposed to be like an album track, just to...
But then there was a really good buzz about it when people were hearing it.
And it already had like a reputation on the underground circuit anyway, so that helped a lot.
Sage, if I didn't think it was going to go as well.
For me,
not as number one, no.
Because I've never released a single. I had no idea where the song would go. Like, it was even like with the album this week, I didn't have a clue. I was just like, I hope we get a top 40 and stuff, because I didn't know what to expect. But with Freak, it was sort of built up to be a number one, and then we were trying not to listen to it because, you know, it'd seem a disappointment if it didn't get there and we'd been expecting that. But it was nice when we got it.
Let me lay it on the line. I've got a little freaking mess inside. And you know that a man is getting through with it. I don't care what they say. I'm not about to pay nobody's way. Cause it's all about the dog. Against the me, 'cause we can.
thing that has made it a bit easier for the Sugar Babes this time around is that they are a little bit older and wiser. They're also no longer restricted to only working 72 days a year.
Yeah, we don't really work, no. We do get to work as much as we work now anyway, thank God. Because it was like only 72 days a year.
So that's like 3 times a week.
And that's only like how many couple of hours a week as well.
Yeah. But so we were living it easy.
We were living it easy, but at the same time, but with the studio, we worked hard with.
Yeah.
We were there like 24-7 trying to get our album.
Band rehearsals as well. Mm. And they like really got us, because before, you won't believe this, but I couldn't even. When I used to sing, you wouldn't hear a word I was saying because I had like problems with projection and stuff. So seriously, like, I was like, you couldn't hear one word I was saying. So when we got into band rehearsal, like, we had to spend like extra hours in there just to try and get us used to like singing live with a mic.
It makes it much easier now, isn't it? Because, you know, doing it now, it's not a big new thing to us. It's like, we've done it before, go in, rehearse with the band and
work so much, you forget that you are doing so much because you're enjoying it and you just automatically do it. You get up and you just go, where are we going today?
And it goes much quicker as well if you just enjoy it.
I was saying today, like, it's amazing how many things you can fit into a day. Like, we've come from Manchester to Ireland and then we're going back to London to do a gig at 1:30 in the morning after here. But it's fun, you know, but it's good because we're performing a lot.
Yeah.
Which is what we love to do.
We've got a day off a week on Monday.
Have we?
Oh, is it?
Really? Yeah. Wow, we've got 2 weeks off in October.
Yeah.
That'd be nice.
But I think the weeks, whenever we take time off, it goes quite fast.
Know,
and you're just sitting there.
I get bored when we get it. We had 2 days off the other week.
I love
and
it.
I couldn't wait for it. And I was like, I'm really tired, I need to sleep. And then I was just like sitting like that in my flat, nothing to do. So
we live like 2 minutes away from each other, so
we normally see each other.
We
will
have a bump into each other.
And we're used to it.
Or we're going
anyway.
To the same raves or something. Because obviously we like the same music.
We end up going to the same, because our friends run different nights in London, and so we always go to their nights, and we always bump into each other.
Any worries that freak like me might prove difficult to follow up have already proved unfounded. Round and Round has given the band its second consecutive number one.
Round was we went away for a week to a studio and we're writing different songs, and one of the girls who was there, she'd written the chorus of Round Round and played it to us and asked us to record it. Yeah. And then we were asked to like write verses to go with it, and we couldn't really think of anything, so the producer gave us like loads of different samples of music, like different tempos and different styles. And we all wrote verses to all the different ones and then just picked out and messed around and fitted them in. So that's why sometimes the lyrics don't really make sense to me.
No, they don't. The second number one was a lot more moving. It was just like,
because the first... They didn't react at all on the first
one. It was like, oh, wow, okay, number one for Freak Like Me. But this time round, when Round Round was number one, we literally did have tears in our eyes.
It was just like, it felt really, really weird.
Yeah.
And Mitty and I had written the B-side, and it was like, I don't know, it felt really weird. I've never ever had a reaction to anything, probably because we haven't had a top 10 in years.
We just finished the morning TV and we came out.
That's true.
And our tour manager said, oh, we've had the midweek and it's... And we were like, what? And she said, number one. And we were like, oh my God. And then we were like, yeah, but how close is it? And she was like, you're some miles ahead. So we were just like,
yeah.
And that was only midweek as well.
Needles for like the whole week.
Yeah.
You're still kind of nervous because you don't know where it's going to turn out. And as for the album, it's the honest God truth. I personally thought that it was, I thought, okay, top 40. Because our tour manager said it's probably going to go into like probably the top 30 and then build, you know, just like
the other groups.
It went straight into number two and we were just like, huh?
We're just really pleased that the album's doing well. Yeah. I mean, that's more than you can ask for.
We don't have a plan.
We're just really working and little by little setting goals.
Yeah. But I think the main thing at the moment is, you know, just releasing the songs and hopefully doing a tour next year, because we didn't get a chance to do it.
And we're already starting to write the next album now. Yeah. So, very busy.
Yes.
You stare in my face, you're messing with my brain. If you try to convince me, then you better think again. If you move to the music's got to give. If it's too complicated, that's the way I wanna live. If you hate me, I will show you how to break me into something.
was I.